Greetings, dear brothers and sisters, in the holy, mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Yeshua Ha Mashiach, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Once again, to Messiah and Messiah alone be all the praise, honor, and glory. And today is the 22nd day, right, David?
Yes.
Yeah, today is the 22nd day of the third month of the year 2018, dear brothers and sisters. Today I'm here to help our five-year-old son, David. Today, as a matter of fact, the Lord is leading us to do something unusual, which we don't usually do on this channel. But today, David actually got a dream. He got it back to back in 2 days. Twice he got it. So the Lord is leading us, prompting us to share this dream. So here we are, dear brothers and sisters, in obedience to the Lord. David will share his dream with us. He actually tried to draw the picture about the dream, which is he's trying to draw the vine and the branches and about Jesus and a gardener, and he will talk. David will explain it to us when he tells about his dream. So here we are, dear brothers and sisters. It's a very encouraging dream. Messiah again is pointing to us about the importance of the vine and the branches, the times we are living in, how close we are indeed, so very close, dear brothers and sisters, where our faith is about to be sight. We indeed do walk by faith, as the Bible tells us, 2 Corinthians 5:7. But our faith is about to be sight, dear brothers and sisters. Although we are weary, we are tired, Messiah does know, dear brothers and sisters, that which is the perfect time, because he always knows, he and he alone, dear brothers and sisters, always know the perfect time, the perfect thing which we need. So, dear brothers and sisters, once again, before we begin, dear brothers and sisters, we wanted to mention that regarding the prayer request, dear brothers and sisters, if any one of you have any prayer request, dear brothers and sisters, please don't hesitate to email us. We will leave it in a description box, our email ID. So please don't hesitate to email us. Help us, dear brothers and sisters, to pray for you, because praying, as we see all through the Pauline epistles, as we learn from Paul, that praying for each other, dear brothers and sisters, is a privilege, which Paul teaches us all through the scriptures, that our prayers are indeed a heavy artillery weapon which works at a distance. And as we keep praying for each other, we glorify God. We get strengthened in Messiah and we glorify God, and let's keep praying for each other. So, dear brothers and sisters, also, we wanted to mention, dear brothers and sisters, all of you who have asked for prayers, dear brothers and sisters, our dear fellow brethren, we are indeed praying for each and every one of you, dear brothers and sisters, so that Messiah's mighty will can be accomplished in each one of you. And we do claim every single day, dear brothers and sisters, on Philippians chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 11 and 12, and Colossians chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, for each of our fellow brethren who have asked for prayers, so that Messiah's mighty will can be accomplished. And dear brothers and sisters, once again today, before we begin, as we keep telling, let us please invite the presence of God, because these are once again supernatural messages, dear brothers and sisters. It should be done in the presence of God. It should be the only the Spirit of God. John 16:13, 1 Corinthians 2:14 tells us that only the Holy Spirit can lead us to absolute truth. Without the Holy Spirit, we will be in our flesh. And we don't want to be there, dear brothers and sisters, because Romans chapter 8, verses 6 through 8 has a strong warning about being in flesh and being in the Spirit. So before we begin today, let's start with a word of prayer then. Shall we, David?
Yes.
All right. Our Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, that you have given us one more day to breathe, one more day filled with your divine protection, your divine promises, your divine providences. We thank you, Lord, that you have given us one more day to glorify you, to honor you, to praise you, Father. We thank you, Lord, for the extremes, incredible extremes, Father, you went on our behalf so that we might live. And today we might have a life in abundance. We thank you, Father, that by your grace and your grace alone, you have called each one of us, and not by any merit of our own. God's riches at Christ's expense. We thank you, Father, today that you have allowed your Son, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, to purchase our liberty from the law to purchase our redemption, our access to you, Lord. Father, we also thank you today for the Holy Spirit, Ruach HaKodesh, that he is so diligent to open the scriptures to the diligent. I pray, Father, today we pray that if you would please do increase in each one of us, in our dear fellow brethren, in our dear brothers and sisters, a new appetite, a renewed hunger for your word and for you, that we each may grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord, but also, Father, that we each might be more discerning, more perceptive to what you precisely have for each one of us in the days that remain, which is extremely, extremely short. And we thrill, Father, today as we discover once again in your word, through the warnings you are giving us, the exciting demonstrations and of precision, of your precision and of your love, Lord, for each one of us. And yet, Father, as we behold the horizon and we sense the urgency of the perilous times we are living in, we do seek discernment, Father, that we might know what it is you would have each one of us do precisely. We understand, Father, that opportunity is not mandated, that you have called each one of us to a specific task. Oh, Father, today I pray once again that you would, through your Holy Spirit, please make that evidently clear to each one of us, to our dear fellow brethren, to our dear brothers and sisters, that in the days that remain, we might be each more faithful and more fruitful stewards of the opportunities you're presenting us with. Father, today I bring myself and David in your presence. And we pray, Lord, as David is about to convey your message about your dream to your appointed people, please be our strength, Lord. Please be our strength, Father, that when we are weak, and we claim on Psalm chapter 141, verse 3, and pray, Father, that please do set a guard over our mouths, and please do keep watch over the door of our lips as we convey your message to your appointed people. And right this moment, in the name of our King Yeshua Ha Mashiach, using our authority of Luke 10:19, we bind every single evil of the enemy which is coming at this time, which is coming at this video, which is coming at our dear fellow brethren, our dear brothers and sisters, and we pray for the hedge of protection for each one of us. And Father, we pray once again that may this message reach to your appointed people to accomplish your mighty will, and please do enlighten all of our hearts and minds, the hearts and minds of our dear fellow brethren, through your Holy Spirit, to understand that what you precisely have for them through this message. All this we pray in the holy, mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen and amen and amen.
Amen.
All right, you can please go ahead, David.
I had this dream twice, on the 11th day of the third month, as well as on the 12th day of the third month, of this year 2018. I saw a big vine which was very tall. But Jesus Christ took me to the vine and said, "This vine is like me, and the branches are like the people who believe in me. The branches that bear fruit are the only ones who believe in me. The fruit which is like the juicy grapes. But the big fire next to the vine is for the branches which do not bear fruit. The fruit is my work, the fruit of the Spirit. The big fire next to the vine represents the lake of fire. The branches which do not bear fruit are the ones who don't truly believe in me, and they don't have ever eternal life. Because my word says in John 3:16 that whoever believes in me only will have eternal life. The one who doesn't believe in me doesn't bear the fruit of the Spirit, and soon and very soon they will be thrown into the lake of fire. But my son, the ones which bear fruit will be pruned so that the new branches can bear more fruit. So my son, If you believe in me, you will bear more fruit. The fruit of the Holy Spirit, which is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, trusting in me, gentleness, and controlling yourself. Amen. And in the dream, I also saw a man who looked like a gardener who was doing all these things that Lord Jesus Christ was explaining to me. And that was the end of the dream. Thank you, everybody, for letting me share the dream which Lord Jesus Christ gave me. And may Lord Jesus Christ bless you all abundantly. Amen.
Amen and amen and amen. Thank you so much, David, once again for sharing with us your dream and about the vine and the branches. Dear brothers and sisters, as I was telling that this is something unusual in the sense, dear brothers and sisters, the Lord doesn't lead us to share dreams on this channel. Usually, a long while back, we shared a dream of Anna and our 8-year-old daughter, and then we get to share this as the Lord is leading us. Not that we don't get dreams, dear brothers and sisters, but the Lord leads us to share more on about the words and the visions. We indeed do pray over every single dream, every single word, every single visions, every single supernatural experiences which the Lord gives us. And as the Lord leads, dear brothers and sisters, that's how we share. But today, this is a back-to-back dream which he got on the 11th day of the third month of this month of this year, of course, and the 12th day. Brothers and sisters, it's a back-to-back dream. Does it make it more important? I have no answer to that, dear brothers and sisters. Those are things which we need to take it to the Lord. But we do understand, dear brothers and sisters, that from the Bible, we see today we will, as the Lord is leading us, we will read, as a matter of fact, maybe the first 7 or 8 verses of the wine and the branches discourse, which in the upper room discourse which Messiah was having, which started in John 14 and John 13, as a matter of fact. And in John 15, Messiah is talking about the vine and the branches metaphor. So last time we were talking about the sheep and the shepherd metaphor, when we were talking about the metaphor where Jesus was talking about in John 10, the good shepherd discourse. Dear brothers and sisters, now we see in the sheep and shepherd, we were saying that the sheep basically had only it's the shepherd who is keeping the sheep, and we see the same pattern here. It's the vine which is keeping the branches, but here Messiah is stepping up at this point of time in the sense that now the branch has a responsibility. The sheep didn't have a responsibility to bear fruit or do things alike, which as Messiah was talking in John 10, but in John 15 now, as Messiah is using this metaphor to compare between Messiah and the believers to the vine and the branches, Messiah is now holding us accountable that we have a responsibility to bear fruit. And that's what David tried to draw in this picture. It's basically he saw a huge vine with some of the branches bearing fruit, and that's the kind he was trying to draw the grapes as best as he could, I guess. And that was the gardener David tried to draw. And that's the fire which he saw next to the vine. So dear brothers and sisters, we hope that we could convey that dream. And today let's just dig in to what the Bible says about the vine and the branches, dear brothers and sisters. Whenever our Messiah gives us a dream, a vision, or a word, we need to once again go back to the scripture and see what Messiah exactly has for each one of us through the scripture, because he might give us a dream, and when we revisit the scripture which is talking about it, then the Spirit of God can guide us and talk to us about what exactly he has, and oftentimes it is so. So today we will be reading the John chapter 15. I believe we'll do first 8 verses, the true vine, where Messiah talks about, as John records in John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. We will be doing the first 8 verses, of course, dear brothers and sisters. Please do once again feel free to use your own Bible or follow along, dear brothers and sisters. It's first 8 verses. Please hold on with us, dear brothers and sisters. We encourage you to let's read this together so that and try to understand what the Lord is telling us today. Dear brothers and sisters, in the end of the end of the end moments, we will feel like, well, I know the story. I know I heard about vine and branches, dear brothers and sisters. When the word is living and active, as Hebrews chapter 4 verse 12 tells us, every single time we can read the same discourse and every single time Messiah will talk to us differently because the word is living and active and a double-edged sword, dear brothers and sisters. So every time we need to revisit whatsoever, if we have read over it, Messiah, the author, if we invite the Holy Spirit, the author, he will talk to us every single time, whatever, to accomplish his purpose. So that's what makes the Bible as a supernatural text. Everything is put together. It has a design. And every single time we revisit the same passage which we read, every time Messiah has a different way to talk to us. So dear brothers and sisters, today let's see what Messiah has. So please invite the Spirit of God. Let the Ruach flow, dear brothers and sisters. Let the Spirit of God, Ruach HaKodesh, flow. Let's not obstruct the Ruach HaKodesh. Let's just yield to the Spirit of God. And let's jump in John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. We will be reading and we will be using a New King James Version. So here Messiah says, I am the true vine and my Father is the wine dresser. So as soon as we read this, dear brothers and sisters, why did Messiah not say, I am the vine and my Father is the wine dresser? What does it mean to say that I am the true vine? Why is Messiah emphasizing on true? As a matter of fact, this word in Greek, true, is alethine. A-L-E-T-H-I-N-E, alethine. The word in Greek for true is alethine, which distinguishes Messiah's reality and genuineness from that which is false and unreal. That implies that there is a false wine. And dear brothers and sisters, wine dresser is of course our Heavenly Father, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. So he says, Messiah says, I am the true vine and my Father is the wine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. So dear brothers and sisters, here we see the wine dresser, our Heavenly Father, cuts both the branches that produce and that do not produce fruits. And both of them have a different purpose altogether. This is verse 2 and verse 6. Talks about the two different kind of branches and the two different kinds of outcomes which these branches have. The barren branches are removed so as not to affect the health of the rest, which are the healthy branches. Moreover, the fruit, as we see here, the fruit-bearing branches are also pruned so that it can bear more fruit. And Messiah continues in verse 3, you are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. That's the present tense. You are already cleaned here. So basically, pruning is basically the act of cleansing. The spiritual counterpart is the cleansing which is done through the word of God. We see the psalmist tell us in Psalm 119, I believe, verse 9. How can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word. And dear brothers and sisters, how are we cleansed? Messiah is telling you are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. And our authority, our references are Psalm 119 verses 9, verse 67, verse 71, and then 2 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 1. Dear brothers and sisters, as we keep talking about the scriptures, dear brothers and sisters, we implore you, dear brothers and sisters, once again to be active Bereans. Let the bride be active Bereans, transformed by Ruach HaKodesh, by the Spirit of God. And when we dig in the scriptures, we don't hear people talking scriptures with the whole counsel of God. We just like to pick out some half of the scripture or one verse theology or things alike and talk and build up on that with our own emotions, own flesh and own thoughts, dear brothers and sisters. That's eisegesis. That's reading into the text. Let the text talk. Let's do an exegesis when we let the text talk, what the text is telling. Because Bible, when we let God talk, we do an exegesis of the scriptures. So we do implore you, the scriptures, which the cross references, which we talk about here. Now we are talking about cleansing. Please do go back, dear brothers and sisters. If the Lord leads you, let the Spirit of God guide you to read those scriptures. There is, on weekend, lose anything by reading those scriptures, dear brothers and sisters. There's nothing to lose. Perhaps God has something to talk to us, a streamlined message through those scriptures. And that only when we go there, read the scripture, that's how we will know, dear brothers and sisters. So basically, how can we be cleansed by the word? So, and our cross references were, our authority was Psalm chapter 119, verses 9, 67 and 71. And 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. So when we are basically pruned by the Master, count it all joy, as James tells us, James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. As Paul tells us in Romans chapter 5, verses 3 through 5. And we will once again encourage you, please do go back and read the scriptures. Perhaps God has something for you going on there, dear brothers and sisters. So continuing to the true wine in John 15, verse 4. Abide in me, Messiah says, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. Dear brothers and sisters, this abide word is going to be astonishing as we finish this discourse today. Not finishing, rather, by verse 8. As we stop this discourse at verse 8, we will see how crucial, how important this word abide will turn out to be, which we are thinking trivial. It is not. It has an outcome which can change the outcome of our entire eternity, dear brothers and sisters. It can change the outcome of our Bema Seat judgment. That's how crucial this word abide is. So here Messiah says in verse 4, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. Brothers and sisters, once again, this abide will be an astonishing word study to go through the scriptures, all across the scriptures, from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 20, chapter 22, verse 20. Dear brothers and sisters, it will be rewarding all your effort in Lord, in whatever you're doing, will never be in vain. Our authority, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58, all your efforts, whatever you're doing in the Lord with a true heart, with a pure heart, not with other intentions. If you do with a true and pure heart, God says that it is written in His book. And on that day, the Bema Seat judgment, when we will be standing for the rewards, the inheritance and rewards, those books will be opened and you will be rewarded. We, each one of us, will be rewarded in the Lord. No, none of our effort will be in vain when it is done in truth, in spirit, when we mean it in the heart. So abide here is the Greek word for menate, M-E-I-N-A-T-E, M-E-I-N-A-T-E, menate, which means to remain or to stay. Abiding, dear brothers and sisters, cannot come without obedience. Dear brothers and sisters, a lot is being propagated on YouTube, on various social platforms, about different kind of things, about salvation by grace. And yes, it is by grace, dear brothers and sisters. We are not even talking about salvation here. We are saved by grace through faith. We are saved now. What are we saved for? We are not saved by anything, by our works or anything else, but it is the precious blood. Absolutely, the justification is done through the precious blood of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Absolute 100%. There is anything adding to that is blasphemy. But our perspective should be, dear brothers and sisters, we are saved by the precious blood of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. But now what? Why are we saved? That's the greatest discovery of our life, because each one has a calling. And why are we saved? God will tell us. Because each one of us have been given talents to do certain things, and There is a reason why, or there are several reasons perhaps why God has saved us. And God will tell us, dear brothers and sisters. And He is telling us today in His word. One of the reasons why He has saved us is to abide in Him. Abiding has nothing to do with being saved by grace. We cannot, once again, combine so many different things. We need to sort out, we need to break it down to the lowest unit. We cannot keep talking about protein. We have to break it down to the lowest unit of amino acid, whatever, how many of our amino acid. We talk about hemoglobin as a whole molecule. It sounds good, but it has 574 amino acids. We need to break it down and we need to talk and see the attributes of different amino acids for the whole protein to understand how that whole protein molecule will behave. Brothers and sisters, in the same way, as I read somewhere, I don't remember, it says that the author was telling that if you squeeze a lemon, you will get lemon juice should come out of it. If you squeeze orange juice comes out of it. If you squeeze a Christian, Christ should come out of us. Today the question is Christ coming out of us? That's the question, dear brothers and sisters. Are we abiding in Him? And abiding cannot come without obedience. There are so many things being propagated, which is basically diverting us. That's another way of, in these end moments, so that we don't focus on the word. Dear brothers and sisters, salvation has three tenses as we keep talking. We are justified. The penalty of our sins, all our sins are paid in full, but we are saved for a reason. Are we attending to that reason? Are we abiding in Christ? And how do we know we are abiding? Those are things which we need to take to our prayer closet and talk to God about it. Because abiding comes with obedience. Our entire dependency should always be on Messiah and Messiah alone. There is indeed no plan B. Plan B, first of all, in our jargon also it doesn't work. And plan B in biblical jargon is called unbelief. There is no plan B. Dear brothers and sisters, the secret of fruitfulness is found in abiding, in remaining in the true vine. Not in the effort of the branches trying to produce grapes. Not in the effort of the branches trying to produce grapes. That's not what the branches are meant for. Apart from its attachment to the vine, the branch is totally useless. As a matter of fact, even the wood of the vine was of so inferior quality that it was not even permitted to be burned on the temple altar. That's how useless the branches are without the vine. And that's the metaphor Messiah is using for the believers and Messiah, that the relationship we are exploring. And that brings us, dear brothers and sisters, how do we abide? And today we are not going to talk about how abiding and everything, but we will definitely leave you with a couple of scriptures, what Messiah himself says, and then John also records about abiding. Messiah in the same discourse, Messiah says in John chapter 15 verse 10 about abiding. Messiah says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Moreover, we see John also says about abiding in Messiah in 1 John chapter 3 verse 24. Now he who keeps his commandments abides in him, and he in him. And by this we know that he abides in us by the Spirit whom he has given us. Dear brothers and sisters, these are a couple of scriptures out of so many different how to abide in Messiah. Please do take it to your prayer closet, because by the time we finish, this abiding concept will be so very crucial. The outcome, the report card of abiding and not abiding will become so very important by the time we finish today, get to verse 8, dear brothers and sisters. So we do encourage you, please do take about abiding to your prayer closet. And as Messiah, take these two scriptures as your starting point and see what Messiah has. Step by step, he will guide you. And now we move to John 15:5, which everybody, each one of us, have heard it over and over again. So many different times. And it's basically a report card of abiding and not abiding in Messiah. And that's what Messiah is declaring. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Hey, brothers and sisters, we have all heard about it. We have all heard about this scripture so many times. How many times have we stopped to contemplate what Messiah is to do, an exegesis, let the Holy Spirit talk through the text. That I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. How to abide in him? Did we ever go ask the Lord through the text, through the scriptures, to show us how to abide in him? Today is the day, if you haven't, dear brothers and sisters. In this verse, Messiah says, for without me, you can do nothing. Dear brothers and sisters, it is not a question of our sufficiency, of how adequate we are. It is his sufficiency. It is his faithfulness. It is his grace. It is his mercy. It is his love which carries you and me. For without me you can do nothing, Messiah says. Without Messiah we can indeed do nothing, dear brothers and sisters. The branches just bear the grapes. It does not produce the grapes. We need to understand that. But dear brothers and sisters, here's an interesting thought. Why did Messiah compare the believers with vine? Why not out of other trees? Why using vine as the metaphor? That's the point to ponder, dear brothers and sisters, because there are so many different kind of trees Messiah could have used. But we believe, dear brothers and sisters, vine, grapes, they are the only fruit that does not ripen if it is separated from the branch. Only grape is the only fruit which cannot ripen. It will be dying as soon as it is separated from the branch. And that's not so for other fruits. So that's really interesting why Messiah is comparing that. It's astonishing to realize as well, dear brothers and sisters, the depth scriptures have when we really dwell in it and what the Spirit of God guides us, how he guides us. Continuing to verse 6. Now we will see the outcome of whoever abides in him and who is not abiding. Verse 6 talks about not abiding and verse 7 will talk about abiding. The astonishing outcome, the report card is here itself. Please do pay attention. Please, dear brothers and sisters, do pay heed to this. Messiah says, verses 6 and 7 are the most crucial take-home message today. Verse 6 says, if anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire. And they are burnt. And they are burnt. Dear brothers and sisters, they are burnt. And that in itself should be self. The explanation is there itself, dear brothers and sisters. Not abiding in him ultimately results into, as in David's dream today, Messiah Jesus Christ of Nazareth was showing, that those branches which did not bear fruit, they were cut, chopped, and put into the fire. And that fire represented the lake of fire. That's not a good place, dear brothers and sisters. None of us want to be there. When we read the story about the rich man and Lazarus, dear brothers and sisters, that's not a parable. A parable is like an object lesson. But dear brothers and sisters, a parable is for illustration. Dear brothers and sisters, this story is, parables don't have names. This is a real thing which is happening. Lazarus was a real person. There was a name. And the rich man. And God did not know the rich man's name, but he knew Lazarus's name. And when we see the rich man is being tormented in that place, in that fire, dear brothers and sisters, that's where there is not a single drop of water. Millions and millions and infinity amount of years being there. Dear brothers and sisters, that's, none of us want to be there. That's why God paid the price on that cross. If you don't know him today, come to him. Look at the cross. If you have fallen back, whatever it is, for whatever reason, come to him today. He is waiting to talk to you. Because he has, Jeremiah 29:11 tells us that he has plans not to harm you, but to give you hope and future. Time is running out, dear brothers and sisters. Verse 7 tells us, so we see not abiding in him results, what it results into, as in David's dream Messiah was trying to show. Verse 7 is an astonishing verse, dear brothers and sisters. That's a verse which we can take it to the Lord during our valleys, and we can talk to him and see what Lord has. Verse 7, Messiah says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire and it shall be done for you. Let me read this again. If you abide in me, Messiah says, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire and it shall be done for you, dear brothers and sisters. That's an astounding, astounding promise there. Ask what you desire and it will be done. Messiah is not telling if you ask. Messiah is telling ask. I will do it for you. But here's the catch. Let's take a close look. Let's take a close look at this verse. Dear brothers and sisters, we can, as a matter of fact, take this to a prayer closet and hold Messiah accountable if we are asking for our desires and Messiah is not responding to it and you are feeling that Messiah is not. We can hold him accountable. But here's the catch. Here's the catch. There are two preconditions. He said, ask whatever you desire, it will be done for you. But here's the catch. We have to read the verse, the exegesis. Let the text talk to us, not just pick out what we want from it. That, well, Lord, you said whatever I desire, I will ask and you will give. But there is a condition to that. And that has nothing to do with by grace you have been saved through faith. That has nothing to do with that. This is a different scripture. We are talking about Messiah is challenging us today that we can go and talk to him, ask our heart's desire. He will do it. He's not telling if you ask. He's telling ask what you desire. Ask what you desire and it shall be done for you. But here's the catch. There are two preconditions. One is if you abide in me. Number two, if my word abides in you. If you abide in me, if we abide in Messiah, and if Messiah's word abides in us, then and then only we can go and ask anything, whatever our heart desires, and he will do it for us. Because once we abide in him and his word abides in us, then those desires are God-given, dear brothers and sisters. So here is the thing. When we want to ask certain things, there are two preconditions. Messiah is telling that's not our thoughts, not conjecture, not speculation. We can go ask whatever we desire and he will do it for us if we abide in him and his word, Messiah's word abides in us. Dear brothers and sisters, today the word is not being preached from the pulpits or on any social platform. We talk about online churches and things alike, dear brothers and sisters. We are not dwelling and digging deep in the scriptures. And Messiah says that if you abide in me and my word abides in you, he will do anything. Whatever we desire, we ask, he will do it. But the question is, that's why we need to know, dear brothers and sisters, now abiding in Messiah is how important. What does that abiding mean? How do we do it? The brothers and sisters, abiding in his word, we will leave you with a couple of scriptures for that. 1 John chapter 5 verse 14. James chapter 4 verse 3. Abiding in his word. 1 John chapter 5 verse 14. James chapter 4 verse 3. And we need to take every thought captive, dear brothers and sisters. The enemy is implanting thoughts in our brains every moment. We will leave you with 2 Corinthians 10, 5, chapter 10, verse 5, Romans chapter 12, verse 2, dear brothers and sisters. It is so very crucial to understand that abiding in Messiah and not abiding, what's the outcome of that? Not abiding, we see the branches were thrown into fire. They are pruned, they are chopped, they are thrown into fire. Abiding in Messiah and in his word. If we abide in Messiah and my word abides in you. That word abide, we need to do a word study of that. There is a staggering promise outlined there. Astonishing promise that he will do it if we abide. Dear brothers and sisters, today is the day to seek. Please do use these scriptures as a springboard to start this study. So that Messiah can guide you in these end moments. We do know that his return is imminent, but more imminent it is becoming, dear brothers and sisters. The enemy is working so very hard. Let us not forget the parable of the sower, the basic parable for every true believer of Christ, the bird was the Satan who is trying to take away those seeds. Otherwise, it will be either the other two grounds. But we need to be in that good ground. For that, his word needs to abide in us. We need to be bearing fruit. Hey, brothers and sisters, today is the day. Today is the day to dig deeper and understand what this abiding in Messiah means. And dear brothers and sisters, if the Lord leads you to, please do email us. Please do leave us a comment on how what the Lord is doing about abiding. Let's talk about it. As Isaiah says, let us discuss about it. Let us reason together. Let us talk about it. And iron sharpens iron, Proverbs tells us. Let us keep encouraging, just not through vain words, but through the scripture, through the Spirit of God. Because it's the Spirit of Christ which is holding us together. Moving on to verse 8. And that will be our last verse today, dear brothers and sisters. God says, Messiah says, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. So you will be my disciples. Those who are everybody saved by his grace through faith, are everybody abiding in him? Are everybody his disciples? These are questions, dear brothers and sisters. We should not leave them unanswered. We should take it to our prayer closet. Those answers are not found on YouTube. Those are in the scriptures. That's why we need to have that alone time with God. Every single day to dig deeper. To know him better. So by this, Messiah starts verse 8 by telling, by this my Father is glorified. What is this by this? That by this is what we read from verses 1 through 7. It points back to the union with Christ and it points forward to the fruit bearing. And of course, neither of them are an end in itself, but rather to the end of bringing glory to the Father, to our Heavenly Father. So in essence, Messiah is telling us that if we are coupled to him, if we proclaim that we are saved by grace through faith, and we are not even getting into Titus chapter 2 verses 11 through 13, which talks about what will God's grace do in us. But if we truly are Christ's disciples, if we are truly saved by grace through faith, that saving grace, if it has saved us, then we will, if we are coupled to him, we will bear fruit. The branches which are attached to the vine are supposed to bear fruit. If not, we saw in verse 6, the branches which did not bear fruit, what happened to them? That's not fear-mongering. That's what the Bible is telling, dear brothers and sisters. If the Holy Spirit is convicting you right this moment, get on your knees. Please do get to your prayer closet. Messiah has plans for you, not to harm you, but to give you a hope and future. But to give you everlasting life. Because he paid for every single sin. He was pierced for our iniquities. He was bruised beyond imagination for every single sin of us. And by his stripes we are healed. Dear brothers and sisters, today we will leave you with this fruit bearing which Messiah is telling. So two take home messages. Please do take it to your prayer closet about abiding in him. How do we do that? And we, as the Lord led us, we left you with few scriptures. And about the fruit bearing, what exactly fruit bearing means. As David saw in the dream, we saw one aspect of the fruit bearing, the fruit of the Holy Spirit. But there can be seven different kinds of fruit bearing, which is in the scriptures. That's everything is in the scripture. It's in the Bible. Seven different kind of fruit bearing it can be. And dear brothers and sisters, we do definitely encourage you. Please do go back and dwell on those. Let the Spirit of God guide you, dear brothers and sisters. Let God be glorified. Let us decrease. Let our own thoughts, own wishes, own everything, let us decrease. Let us pray, Lord, grind me, crush me down. If it's for your glory, so be it. Today you be glorified. Whatever it takes, dear brothers and sisters. So today there are seven different kinds of fruit we are talking about. The first one, dear brothers and sisters, is the fruit of the Holy Spirit, as David was talking about. which produces character, which is we find in Galatians chapter 5 verses 22 and 23 and Ephesians chapter 5 verse 9. Dear brothers and sisters, once again we emphasize, please do go back to these scriptures, dear brothers and sisters. Galatians chapter 5 verses 22 and 23, Ephesians chapter 5 verse 9. The second one is the fruit unto holiness, which produces conduct. It's Romans chapter 6 verse 22. The third fruit is the fruit of righteousness that produces contentment, that we see in Hebrews chapter 12 verse 11, Philippians chapter 1 verse 11. I repeat, Hebrews chapter 12 verse 11, Philippians chapter 1 verse 11. The fourth fruit, the fruit which the scripture talks about, the fruit of the lips, which is about godly conversation. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 15. The fifth fruit, the fruit of our hands, which produces concrete service for God. Serving God. Proverbs chapter, and the scriptures are Proverbs chapter 31 verses 16 and 31. Proverbs chapter 31 verses 16 and 31. And 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 10 and 14. I repeat, 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 10 and verse 14. Sixth is the fruit of the righteous. And the references are Proverbs chapter 11 verse 30. 30. Proverbs chapter 11 verse 30. 30. Romans chapter 1 verse 13. 1-3. And the last is the seventh fruit, is the fruit of the womb, referring basically to our spiritual children of God, which is implied in Romans chapter 7. Dear brothers and sisters, so today, these are the ways of different kind of fruit bearing which the scripture is talking about. This is in itself is not an exhaustive list or an exhaustive study, dear brothers and sisters. We don't really have the time to do an exhaustive study about abiding and fruit bearing, the different kind of fruit which the scripture is talking about. We can easily spend about 2 to 3 weeks doing a study on that. If we do every day, we do a systematic way of studying that for, let's say, about 45 minutes to an hour. If we spend, we can at least go for 2 to 3 weeks to understand what exactly it is. Dear brothers and sisters, in this end moments, dear brothers and sisters, we are here to encourage each other through the word of God. We are here to exhort each other. We are here to pray for each other. But at the end of the day, dear brothers and sisters, our relationship with Messiah is personal. Swapping YouTube channels won't help us when we stand on that day and the Bema Seat judgment, when we stand after rapture. It won't help any one of us that day for our inheritance and rewards. God has a specific calling on each one of our lives. We need to bear fruit. That's what Messiah is telling in our dreams. That's what Messiah is telling us in John chapter 15 verses 1 through 8 about abiding and bearing fruit. Dear brothers and sisters, today we implore you to take this abiding word extremely seriously, dear brothers and sisters. In these end moments, let us glorify Him. Let us, because Messiah ends, as we ended today, Messiah says, by abiding in Messiah, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. Dear brothers and sisters, we all are saved by grace through faith. For what? To glorify our Heavenly Father, because He has gone through unimaginable extremes. Can you imagine, dear brothers and sisters, as a father looking away from your own son who is hanging on that cross, going through that excruciating pain? We will be so very happy to exchange places on the operation table with as a father, don't we? But being God, Creator Himself, He had to turn away, He had to forsake His own Son who went through that excruciating slaughter. He was given up to butchery for you and me. And why was that? Today, Messiah says, if we abide in Him, it will glorify our Father. It is all about glorifying our Father. Let us glorify Him and Him alone today, so that He and He alone be praised and exalted to the highest. We thank you, dear brothers and sisters, once again. And we hope, dear brothers and sisters, that this dream is encourages each one of us, and this message from the Lord about the vine and the branches encourages each one of us once again today to understand about the how to abide, the outcome of abiding or not abiding, and understanding about the fruit bearing, which is just not limited to the fruit of the Holy Spirit, which is talked in Galatians chapter 5 verses 22 and 23. But we, as the Lord led, we talked about some scriptures. Please do dig deeper, dear brothers and sisters, so that God be glorified through each one of us in these end moments. Because that's the ultimate goal of everything, that He be glorified. Messiah be glorified through each of our single breath. Whatever has breath, let it praise the Lord. Let it glorify Him. And once again, thank you, dear brothers and sisters. We do encourage you once again, dear brothers and sisters. Please, please do take this message to the Lord. And whatever the Lord lays on your heart, dear brothers and sisters, in these end moments, we need to hold hands with each other. We need to glorify Him. We need to pray for each other. Because as we see, the attacks are indeed rampant. As the epistles of John tells us, as Book of Jude tells us, as 2 Peter tells us, apostasy and deception has set in. As they say, the church started with the Acts of Apostles. The church is now ending with the Acts of Apostates. That's where we are, dear brothers and sisters. Let our lights today so shine, so shine, so shine, that when our Heavenly Father looks down on you, He's well pleased with you. When on that day, in one of these days, when Messiah calls you and me, come up hither. Let us not be ashamed. Let us wait for that. Let us be workers who are approved. Let us glorify Him so that on that day He can embrace you and me and tell me and you. Tell us, tell His bride, well done. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Now enter my joy. And let's end with a word of prayer. Shall we, David, today?
Yes.
All right, you can go ahead, please.
Lord Jesus, once again, you bring ourselves in your presence, Lord. And bless the people who are watching us, Lord. And strengthen them, Lord. To bear fruit, Lord. To bear more fruit, Lord. As your coming is very near, Lord. I bring all my thoughts captive to you, Lord, and theirs, Lord. Help them, Lord, as I surrender my thoughts to you, Lord, and myself, Lord, and their thoughts in them, Lord, all the people who are listening to us, Lord. Help them, Lord, to abide in you, Lord, as you told in your words, Lord. In Jesus' holy name I pray all this. Amen and amen and amen.
Amen and amen and amen. Thank you so much, dear brothers and sisters. Once again, let us keep up the faith. Let us fight this good fight. And let us finish this race strong. God bless each and every one of you, dear brothers and sisters. And shalom.